reigning WBC lightweight champion Devin Haney took to Twitter to echo some very familiar sentiments we talked about here on the channel. He said, Ryan Garcia is the true definition of a coward. A few weeks ago, he wanted sympathy because he was having mental health issues. This week, he's talking shit about me. It's funny how, now, he came out after Javier Fortuna found another opponent. How convenient.
Yes.
How convenient indeed.
Quite.
He added, and if Luke Campbell dropped you, what would have Linares done to you? You know, the Jorge Linares that Ryan Garcia didn't fight, the Jorge Linares he bailed on and didn't reschedule a fight with. A valid question, if you ask me.
But that's only if you're asking me.
And let's be real, you never wanted to fight Linares. You ducked him like you ducked me. Luke Campbell, Cool Hand Luke of the United Kingdom, he caught wind of these comments and he chimed in by saying, congrats on your win, lad, but FYI, the shot I dropped Ryan with would have slept you, and Linares is now 3 years past his best. To which Devin Haney replied, calm down, Luke the Fluke. You never won a big fight in your life. Tell me one person that you beat.
Could these be the preliminary makings of a fight?
I wouldn't rule it out, given this exchange. It's a fight that could happen at 135, or it's a fight that could happen somewhere down the line at 140 pounds. Ultimately, it's Devin Haney's comments directed at Ryan Garcia that really brought us back to this subject.
Devin Haney's been getting a lot of shit lately.
A lot of shit based on how he performed in a fight that he actually had. Whereas Ryan, baby Ryan, and his anxiety issues, he's been getting a lot of sympathy. Even when he's running off at the mouth, running his chips, talking shit. You read these comments from Devin Haney, and a question forms in my mind. What determines who certain members of the boxing community...
What
determines who they choose to criticize and who they choose to sympathize with? What determines that? Ryan Garcia pulls out of another fight. Ryan Garcia, who has a reputation for being a little fucking peacock, a little debutante,
right,
a little prima donna. He pulls out of another fight. This time it's because he's having a little mental health issue, a little psychological pity attack, and everybody immediately presumes to feel sorry for him.
Oh.
So sorry for Ryan Garcia. Oh my God, he's having a crisis, an existential crisis. I've been skeptical of him from the very beginning. His mental bullshit, his mentally unfit bullshit. All I see is a guy who has a reputation for complaining and pulling out of fights, pulling out of another fight. That's my view of it. But it's all the flack, all the static that Devin Haney gets, has been getting, that has my attention. I mean, Bob Arum petitions for Vasyl Lomachenko to be elevated to franchise champion. Devin Haney gets criticized for it.
Yep.
He was in line for fight as the interim champion, as the mandatory, and, you know, WBC elevate him to champion. Not through his own doing, through someone else's, but he gets the criticism. Bob Arum!
He did it.
Petitions for franchise status for his fighter.
But let's criticize Devin.
Ryan Garcia pulls out on Fortuna, pulled out on Linares.
He did.
Devin Haney fights Linares, might be set to fight Fortuna. Let's criticize Devin.
It's his fault.
What is?
Not sure, we'll figure it out.
Ryan Garcia says he's not interested in fighting Devin. He's not even interested in fighting for world titles. But let's criticize Devin for being elevated to a world title. Not through his own doing, but someone else's. And let's not criticize Ryan,
right,
for finding a very convenient way around fighting top-tier competition. Because, I mean, that's essentially what that is. You're not going to fight Teofimo. You're not interested in fighting Devin. You're interested in talking shit to Devin by way of social media, but you said you're not interested in fighting him, and you're not interested in fighting for world titles. Well, what the fuck are you interested in?
Let's criticize Devin.
Wait, for what?
I don't know. I want to criticize him.
It's not about explaining things away for Devin Haney. It's about holding Ryan Garcia and some others accountable for their actions. If you're not sold on Devin Haney, and you're not high on Devin Haney, and you think he's chinny, and you think he's a guy who's got far too much hype around him, that's your prerogative. That has absolutely nothing to do with holding Ryan Garcia accountable for the words that come out of his mouth and for the fights he doesn't have.
All right.
If it bothers you that Devin Haney's resume is looking a bit thin these days, why doesn't it also bother you that Ryan Garcia's resume is looking thin, and it's set to look thin for a while since he's not interested in fighting anyone?
Why doesn't that bother you?
You think that Devin Haney doesn't deserve to hold a title. You think that Devin Haney is an email champion, a paper champion. That bothers you. But it doesn't bother you that that only happened because of Bob Arum. Didn't happen because of Devin Haney. Didn't happen because of Eddie Hearn. It happened because of Bob.
You can find out a lot about these people based on what doesn't bother them.
And what does. And what is actually at the heart of the matter for these individuals that are so fucking bothered.
What's really bothering you?
In other news, I'm sure most of you have heard by now, per tweet from Michael Benson, Jake Paul will face former UFC champion Tyrone Woodley
Yay!
On August 28th. What do I think about this story? What do I think about this news? My first reaction to it is that Tyrone seems like a more capable, more able-bodied guy under these circumstances than any of the guys that Jake Paul has fought so far. Keith Idek says, two things to keep in mind related to August 28th as the date for Jake Paul versus Tyrone Woodley. Showtime already announced the card for that night, headlined by David Benavidez and Jose Uzkateki. And on August 28th, Paul versus Woodley would be the third pay-per-view in 5 weeks after Wilder versus Fury 3 and Pacquiao versus Spence. That's a lot of pay-per-views in succession. And that might pose a problem to the Jake Paul versus Tyrone Woodley pay-per-view if all of those pay-per-views were catering to the same audience, but they're not. The boxing fans, what boxing fans are interested in the trilogy between Deontay Wilder and Tyson Fury, those might not be the same people that decide to purchase Paul versus Woodley. The same applies to the Pacquiao versus Spence pay-per-view, a pay-per-view that I think stands a good chance of bringing in some good numbers, though ultimately whether or not it's a success depends entirely upon the operational costs. What did the fight take to put together versus how much money the fight actually generates? That's another conversation entirely.
It really is.
As far as that succession of fights, that succession of pay-per-views, I don't think the
trilogy,
Wilder versus Fury trilogy, or even the Pacquiao versus Spence fight will affect Paul versus Woodley, because
that ain't boxing.
That pay-per-view in particular, it caters to a different audience. It caters to those kids that decided to subscribe to Jake Paul and follow him on social media. And to some effect, it caters to UFC fans. Fans of mixed martial arts that might have followed the career of Tyrone Woodley and think he's the man for the job. Think that he's the man who can finally put an end to Jake Paul's circus. Ultimately, I don't think the aforementioned pay-per-views will affect Paul versus Woodley, because Paul versus Woodley isn't for a boxing fan.
Well, cool, boxing fans ain't gonna buy that fight.
Or even the casual boxing fan. I think that this weekend's upcoming fight, exhibition match, I should say, between Floyd Mayweather Jr. and Logan Paul, Jake's older brother, I think that might lend some insight into how versus Paul versus Woodley is going to go and what those numbers might look like, though ultimately, Paul versus Woodley is actually a hotter ticket than Paul versus Mayweather.
You can believe
Paul
that.
Paul versus Mayweather is an exhibition match.
Last I checked.
It's not a real boxing match. It's not even registered on BoxRec. So who wants to see Floyd Mayweather Jr., a guy who's not known for knocking people out, do a waltz with a YouTuber? And now that Jean Pascal has tested positive for several pharmaceuticals, the only intriguing fight on the entire card, not that it was much of a selling point, as only hardcore boxing fans really know who Badou Jack and Jean Pascal are, better still, the only intriguing, mildly intriguing fight on the card has been affected now that Pascal is out. I think Jack's supposed to be fighting someone else. I don't know who, and I don't care. Better still, there's more intrigue associated with Tyrone Woodley versus Jake Paul, because, you know, maybe Tyrone does stand a good chance of getting the job done, at least a better chance than, you know, Nate Robinson and the very uninspired, uninterested
Dead Bod
Ben Askren.
Yeah, I mean, I think Tyrone can at least do a little better than those guys did.
For those people that want to see Jake Paul get his comeuppance and are interested enough in that to make a purchase, Tyrone would seem like a worthier candidate, a worthier adversary than anybody that Jake Paul has fought so far. And for those people, mixed martial arts fans that want to root their man on, their man Tyrone, and Jake Paul fans, whoever is interested in the stuff that that guy does, well, there's enough there that you can actually sell a couple of pay-per-views. I mean, it wouldn't surprise me if that turned out to be a big hit, a big success for Showtime. And you know, maybe Showtime is selling out. Maybe they are compromising their integrity and their spirit in the name of financial gain, in the name of profits, but that wouldn't be the first time that's happened.
It happens all the time.
Now, I don't imagine that UFC head honcho, UFC
impresario, Dana White, is all that happy to hear that one of his former champions, one of his former fighters, is set to be participating in yet another Jake Paul excursion, another Jake Paul engagement. If something happens to Tyrone, you have to understand, it reflects poorly on Dana, because this used to be one of Dana's fighters. And you would expect that a former mixed martial artist, a former UFC fighter, should be able to hold their own against a fucking YouTuber.
You would.
Even if it is in a boxing ring. They're not actually in there with an elite level boxer. They're in there with a novice boxer that's taken on a YouTuber like himself,
yeah,
a basketball player, and a mixed martial artist, yes, but not a striker,
right,
a wrestler. So you would expect that an MMA fighter, a former UFC champion, should be able to deal with that situation well enough that they don't get themselves knocked the fuck out. And if something happens to Tyrone and he gets fucking smoked, well, it's going to reflect poorly on Dana. It's going to reflect poorly on the sport of mixed martial arts, because your average slack-jawed Gawker is your average slack-jawed Gawker. They're fucking idiot. No understanding of these sports. And you're always hearing mixed martial arts fans talk about how boxing ain't real fighting. It's a limited sport, limited combat. Well, if it's that fucking limited, then it should be easy for a former UFC champion,
right,
to adapt.
Because it's so fucking easy.
You're not in there with Oleksandr Usyk or Maris Bredis or anybody like that. You're not in there with Canelo Alvarez or Floyd Mayweather Jr. You're in there with Jake fucking Paul. Jake Paul, that's it.
That's all.
Is he some kind of fucking enigma that needs to be figured out? He's this complex puzzle, this sophisticated tapestry of pugilism?
Sweet science, bro.
This will be the first fight of Jake Paul's multi-fight deal with Showtime. I think he's under some pressure here. It was all just fun and games before. Isolated incidents, isolated events. This is part of a series, or it could be. There's a lot online here for Jake, assuming he even gives a damn, though I don't really think he does. At least not that much.
He can lose and go back to making YouTube videos.
And finally, super lightweight news. The now former unified champion Jose Ramirez had this to say. He says, Josh will be fighting Jack Catterall and then move to 147. That was my plan too. That was the only option. But now I would like to fight Teofimo for any title he wishes at 140 once Josh vacates all of them. Then I'll chase Josh at 147 for a rematch. I'll get him. And this is a very realistic plan. I told you guys, not sure Taylor versus Ramirez happens.
I'm really not.
As far as Taylor's concerned, he feels like he's got bigger fish to fry. Teofimo isn't even really an undisputed champion. He's got unfinished business with Devin Haney. We talked about that, how a Haney fight might actually represent a greater financial value to young Teofimo. And it's a more winnable fight than a Taylor fight, at least in my eyes, at least right now here in June of 2021, until Teofimo shows me another layer of his game. I don't give him any kind of odds to beat Josh Taylor. I think Josh would batter him if that were the next fight. I think Josh would stop him if that were the next fight. That being said, I'm not completely convinced, at least not right now, that Taylor versus Lopez happens. Jose Ramirez versus Teofimo Lopez. That's a very intriguing proposition, because not only is it possible, it could be a very lucrative endeavor for both fighters.
Could be a pay-per-view.
As Jose Ramirez stated, Josh Taylor and his reign at 140 pounds, you know, it's not going to last that long. He's undisputed. He's going to keep his word and give Jack Catterall that opportunity. In all likelihood, he might beat Jack Catterall and then move up thereafter. He's not going to be at 140 much longer. So all those titles he's holding, they're set to go vacant very soon. The reset button will be hit on the super lightweight division before this year is over. Could very well be. And when it is, there's going to be a lot of titles that's up for grabs. Jose Ramirez versus Teofimo Lopez for some of those titles. That's pay-per-view worthy, folks, because Teofimo Lopez, he does have a bit of a buzz. Let's see how this George Kambosos Jr. fight does on pay-per-view. We know Jose Ramirez.
He's got the Chicanos.
The fight with Josh did very good numbers by way of ESPN. And Jose Ramirez, he's got the inside track with the Chicano boxing fans. As we all know, the Chicano boxing fans love their boxing, and they don't mind purchasing a pay-per-view to root their man on. Their man in that situation would be Jose Ramirez, and Ramirez versus Taylor. The size, the aggressiveness, the punching power, and the pressure of Jose Ramirez versus the slickness and counterpunching of young Teofimo, that's an intriguing enough fight that you could put it on pay-per-view and you could make some money. I want to say that Jose Ramirez
is a fighter through and through. He's not a fighter trying to be a singer, a fighter trying to be a rapper, a fighter trying to be an actor. He's a fighter. He's grounded, centered, doesn't say much.
He doesn't.
But he says what he means.
He does.
I believe that he, unlike some other fighters, may be able to fully recover, fully rebound off the first loss of his professional career because he's not an egomaniac, because he's not a debutante, he's not a prima donna, he's not a peacock, he's a boxer.
And he's not a narcissist.
You know, some guys, they let their egos get a little bit too big for their own good throughout the course of their career. They get all big in the britches, they start drinking their own Kool-Aid, believing their own hype, they suffer a loss, they don't know how to recover from that psychologically. Jose Ramirez doesn't strike me as one of those fighters. But a career best win over Maurice Hooker, made himself a lot of money crossing over to DAZN for a one-off, one-time engagement, and he was the same guy afterwards. He was the same guy.
He's a man of the people.
Real down-to-earth stuff, salt-of-the-earth stuff, flannel shirt stuff, jeans, that kind of stuff. That's the kind of guy he is. He doesn't have any illusions about anything, and it's for that reason that I actually think he won't have as hard a time recovering from the loss, rebounding from it, as someone else might, because he's not an egomaniac.
It's possible he becomes a champion again.
It's entirely possible that once Josh Taylor does what he needs to do, what's left to do, in the 140-pound division, he moves up, he vacates those titles, the reset button gets hit on the super lightweight division, it's conceivable that Jose Ramirez could see himself becoming a world champion once again and squaring off against Teofimo Lopez. I like the idea of that.
I'll buy that for a dollar.
More like $80. But all the same, it's a good fucking fight. I like the sound of that.